Good morning again, everyone.
Good morning.
Happy Sabbath to you all.
Happy Sabbath.
Yes, I think it's wonderful that the day is a dry day today, because I wouldn't want to go out if it was all drizzly and rainy outside. I'm going to get on with things this morning because time is short, but I just wanted to see who has the nicest smile today. Let me just have a quick look around and see who has the... You see how these children have to get their teeth out when okay. Let me have a look. Which one? Okay, I'm looking around. Everybody, I can see some fingers pointing. Okay. All right. Okay. I know fingers are pointing in different directions at the moment, but sister, I'm going to give it to you. Yes, I am indeed. You come on, stand right on that. Just show that big smile to everyone who is here today. That's it. Come on now. Let me stand. That's it. Here's a big amen. Okay, that's it. Did you all see it? Or is it on second viewing? Alright, okay, that's all right. And I still think I'm going to go with the looking for the best dressed person in church today. Okay, you can put your teeth away now. However you came to church this morning, that's how it's going to be, okay? Alright, okay. Can I give you my opinion on this one? This is my personal. Look, I'm just looking at my own surprise. I'm going to go with, I'm going to go with sister right here. Your sister right here, can you stand and just, your sister right here, that's right. Can we have a big amen? Hey! Well done. I actually do believe that I suffer from this thing called sand. Is it seasonal? What's it called? Affective disorder. I thought it was adjustment. Whatever it is, I know it's sad. But I do feel that sometimes I do suffer from this thing. But one of the things that's making me so happy at the moment is our Bible study class on a Wednesday. I can tell you, these young people here, I go to bed on a Wednesday night and I wake up in the middle of the night laughing. I can't tell you, these guys, they give me some good jokes, in the night. And they confess, they like to confess the sins. Ooh, I'm telling you, we should hear some of the things they confess to me. Which is all the more remarkable, considering that most of their parents are sitting right behind them. And you know, say confession is good for the soul. I'm telling you. Oh, it's Jihad John. Have you guys been reading about Jihad John in the newspapers?
Yeah,
Jihad John?
Yeah.
You heard of it? Yeah. Okay, well, Jihad John kind of been catching my eye in the newspaper for the last couple of weeks, because I think he first kind of hit the headlines when he beheaded this American journalist, James Foley, I believe is that. And I don't know if I've got this mixed up or right or wrong, but is he the one that's holding the British charity worker, Alan Henning, as well?
Yeah.
And threatening to do the same, I won't make a light of that one there, because that's not funny by any means, but he's threatening to do the same thing to Alan Henning. And I don't know how you guys get along with that whole idea there, but me personally, I'm kind of horrified. I've seen these things before on YouTube where crazy people kind of take machetes and chop people up. But it kind of really does horrify me that Jihad John has done something like this and is still going to do something like that. And in my own mind's eye, I try to work out what's going on with him that he should want to do something like this. Now, I'm going to be honest and say that me personally, I'm guessing that there's some kind of something not quite right at some point. But because these killings have a religious nature about them, I'm kind of trying to work out what it is. And there's a part of me that says that Jihad John is doing what he believes his God wants him to do, okay? And this, what he's doing, is the way that Jihad John understands that his God is like. And the reality is that all Jihad John wants to do is to be like his God. Is that it? That's all he wants to do. And that's the scary bit for me. Because, in actual fact, that's all that we want to do as well, isn't it? Isn't that right? All that we want to do is to be like our God and to do the things that our God wants us to do. And in fact, Jesus in our scripture, we can get the scripture reading up on the screen, it's Matthew 5, 43 to the end. And if you look at the very last verse, Jesus himself says that we should be perfect. That's it. We should be perfect just as our Father in heaven is perfect. The only problem is that being perfect means being perfect. Do you understand what I mean by that? When I became a Christian, being perfect meant controlling my behavior. I had to stop smoking, stop drinking, stop gambling, stop taking drugs. Yeah, I'm confessing my sins as well, that's right. Stop having sex outside of marriage. Being a Christian meant that I had to look like a Christian, walk like a Christian, talk like a Christian, and behave like a Christian. Now, I guess those of you who know me know that I was in trouble from the beginning anyway with that one there. Because quite literally, I gave up smoking, drinking, and all of that kind of stuff 3 weeks before I was actually baptized, okay? And what happened is about 3 months after I was baptized, I started smoking again, though. Benson Hedges it was. And it took me about another 3 months before I could actually quit smoking altogether, all right? Now, let me tell you that in those 3 months that I was struggling to stop my smoking, I was really wrapped up in a sense of guilt. I don't know if anybody knows what I'm talking about here. I was wrapped up in a sense of guilt. And not only guilt, but there was also a sense of shame. And the shame part of it came because I was trying to hide what I was doing from the rest of the church. Okay? Hide what I was doing from the rest of the church. Because, hide what I was doing from the rest of the church. And here's the problem with perfection. If perfection means that I have to be perfect. And I can't help but wonder how many of us have come to church today actually struggling with something or the other. Okay? But we're too ashamed to talk about it because we are afraid that other people will think that we are not good enough to be a Christian. So the problem with perfection is that it means being perfect. But what if being perfect doesn't mean being perfect? Get that one? Let's read what Jesus is actually talking about in Matthew 5. If we can roll it back to verse 43. So Matthew 5 and verse 43. Now we're going to read, guys, right the way down to the end of the chapter, okay? Okay, Tisha? So let's read. I mean, if you want to read with me, read right along. And it says, "You have heard that it was said, you shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy. 44. But I say to you, love your enemies, bless those who curse you, do good to those who hate you, and pray for those who spitefully use you and persecute you. Next one. That you may be sons of your Father in heaven, for he makes his son rise on the evil and on the good, and sends rain on the just and the unjust. Next one. For if you love those who love you, what reward have you? Do not even the tax collectors do the same? Next one. And if you greet your brethren only, what do you do more than others? Do not even the tax collectors do so? 48. Therefore you shall be perfect, just as your Father in heaven is perfect. Now, I don't know how you read that particular passage of scripture, but let me tell you how I read it. Jesus isn't actually talking about behavior. He's talking about the way we relate to people. Jesus is saying that God is not perfect because he doesn't smoke or drink or all of that. Jesus is saying that God is perfect because he cares for and loves everyone the same. Regardless of how we behave, God still gives us life and health and family. Regardless of how we behave, God still makes his sun to shine on all of us. If perfection doesn't mean being perfect, then nothing that I can do can actually make me good enough to be a Christian. What makes me good enough to be a Christian is the blood of Jesus. It's the love of God that was poured out on Calvary's tree. The perfection Jesus is talking about has nothing to do with behavior. Nothing to do with the way we dress, nothing to do with the food we eat, nothing to do with the way we sing in church. Being perfect has everything to do with the way we relate with other people. It means that if someone is struggling with something, I don't have to judge them. All I have to do is to support and encourage them. It means that I can look past the behavior of the person and see the human need. Can you imagine what our church would be like if perfection was all about the way we relate to other people?
Amen.
What would the color of a person's skin matter? Would gender or age or lifestyle matter? Perfection, to me, means being like Jesus. Jesus cared for and loved people enough to come down from heaven and talk to us about a better way of living our lives. Perfection means being like Jesus. Each of us caring for and loving people enough to talk to them about a better way of living their lives. I want to finish by going back to Jihad John, if I can. I ask myself the question, does God approve of what Jihad John is doing? And the answer is no, he doesn't. Question two, does God love Jihad John? And the answer is yes, he does. Just exactly as he loves any one of us here today. Jihad John will have to be accountable for his choices and his actions. But I pray that our God will break the power of Satan over him and that he will let Alan Heaven go free. Today is the power of 35,000, and it is an opportunity for us to express our love for Jesus to the people in our community by giving out these little leaflets that we have here and this card that says that we have a community prayer team right here. Now, folks, considering everything that Jesus has done for me personally, I will be glad to go. And I hope that all of you will be glad to go too.
Thank you, Pastor, for that. Amen.
Amen.
We're just going to have a closing prayer to close our